Hi, my name is Amanda Adeleye. I'm in the Division of Reproductive Endocrinology and Infertility, and I got into transgender care because when I was a medical student like you, I actually had an experience where one of my teachers had some pretty interesting things to say about the transgender community. And though I hadn't known anybody at the time who was out as transgender, I was a little offended and surprised, and it had to do with their reproductive care and how they built a family. And so I just put that in my back pocket as, in the future, it'd be really nice to figure out how to help transgender people have families. And now, I think almost 10 years later, I'm getting to do what I want, which is help transgender people build families. And so to begin, this is part 4, and I'd like to talk a little bit with you about clinical care for our transgender patients. To begin, we'll talk about the unique points of clinical care for transgender individuals. Before we talk about that, I think it's important to reflect on how we could impact patients and what their perspective is when they see clinicians for the first time. So one patient, and this is from the Fenway Clinic, said, "I want my provider to know me. I just can be shy about just saying it, so asking the right questions or having a form I can fill out so I don't have to feel hidden is helpful to me." So it's important to recall that we do not all use the same words or names to talk about our body parts. It's important to establish the words that we use with patients. This starts with the desired pronoun. For instance, some people might use common pronouns such as he or she, others might use they, or less commonly known ones such as Z or Zay. So start off by asking, what are your preferred pronouns and what's your preferred name? In terms of body parts, some people are very comfortable using clinically specific names and others use more common names such as butt or backhole or front sex. It depends, so just ask. According to the CDC, when doing an intake with your patients, it's important to ask about 5 important P's: partners, practices, protection for STDs, past history of STDs, and prevention of pregnancy. I like the Fenway Clinic's take on this by adding 3 additional Ps: preferences, pleasure, and partner violence. In terms of the 8 Ps, let's begin with preferences. You might ask your patients, do you have a preferred language that you use to refer to your body parts? Or are you currently on hormonal therapy? Have you had any gender-confirming surgeries? This is also a good time to ask about pronouns. In terms of partners, you might ask, how would your partners identify themselves in terms of gender? And as far as practices are concerned, it's important to ask about various toys that one might use or any other types of intercourse that haven't been mentioned before. In terms of the remaining P's, it's important to ask about sexually transmitted infections. This might include any prior history of sexually transmitted infections and where they might have occurred, and finally, if they use any sort of barrier protection. In terms of pregnancy, I actually like to expand this to think about family building. So either, are you planning on having children at some point in the future? And if you are you doing anything to prevent that right now? Do you need us to help you do anything to help you have children in the future? In terms of pleasure, it's important to ask your patients about this because with certain gender-affirming treatments, this might have an impact on their sexual life. Sometimes some medications can decrease libido, and other times surgeries might decrease sensation. So it's important to ask because there are ways we might be able to help your patient. Finally, it's important to ask about intimate partner violence. It doesn't discriminate by gender. One excellent resource for clinical care for transgender people is the Center of Excellence for Transgender Health. This particular resource is actually produced here at UCSF, but it's used nationally. Here you can find information about how to take care of your patients, good clinical resources, and also resources for patients. Thinking about our patients on the feminine spectrum, it's important to see them in clinic every 3 to 6 months, and for them to get labs every 6 to 12 months. In terms of a clinical evaluation, it's important to get vital signs, and then also if they're adolescents, Tanner staging. In terms of labs, we like to get prolactin, serum estradiol, and testosterone, annotated here as T. Initially, it's important to get them every 3 months while you're titrating their hormones, but eventually you can spread it out to every 6 to 12 months. And finally, it's important to get a 25 hydroxylase vitamin D. It's also important to get a bone mineral density scan, also known as a DEXA, every 1 to 2 years until the age of 25 or 30. Finally, in terms of routine cancer screening, if a patient has no increased risk of breast cancer, they should follow breast cancer screening guidelines for cisgender women. Additionally, it's important to follow the screening guidelines for prostate cancer recommended for cisgender males. That's typically a digital rectal exam at the age of 50 or above and may include a prostate screening antigen test. In some cases, you may be the surgeon for a transgender patient, or you might be the clinical provider for a patient, and it might be important to do a pelvic exam. Some patients might have a neovagina. It's important to look that it's cosmetic and has intact neurological sensation. Initially, after formation of a neovagina, patients will use dilators to keep the vagina patent and prevent stricture postoperatively. Once it's ready to use, in other words, once it's healed, if they're going to have regular penetrative activity, that should be enough, but if not, they need to continue to use dilators. Finally, it's important to remember, on digital inspection, only if necessary, that they will have a blind cuff. These are examples. In this picture, this is immediately postoperatively, and you can see that there's some scar tissue where the new labia have formed. Here, this is several months later in another patient, and you can see that everything is well healed. Thinking about our patients on the masculine spectrum, they also should be seen every 3 to 6 months in clinic and have lab monitoring every 6 to 12 months. Again, in terms of their clinical exam, basics include taking vitals and Tanner staging for your adolescent population. In terms of labs, if our patients are on testosterone, they need special labs, including a complete blood count, liver function test, and additionally hemoglobin A1C and lipid panel. These should be taken every 3 months initially, and then up to once a year or once every 2 years. We should be measuring testosterone, and again, the physiologic range is somewhere between 320 to 1,000 nanograms per deciliter. In terms of estradiol, it's important to check it in the first 6 months, and ideally it should be less than 50. Also, it's important to check that they have a good bone mineral density by doing a DEXA scan every 1 to 2 years. If a cervix is present, it's important to do routine pap screening. It's important to remember to also do chest screening for patients. As a reminder, many transgender men might refer to their upper body part as their chest instead of breast. However, if they've not had a mastectomy, it's important to do chest or breast cancer screening as dictated for any cisgender woman. In terms of the physical exam, again, if you are the surgeon or you are one of the primary clinical providers, you might be asked to do a pelvic exam on the patient. For some patients who've had bottom surgery, they might have had a metoidoplasty or phalloplasty. So for the metoidoplasty or phalloplasty, there's an increased risk of post-op skin flap infections or hematomas. Long-term, there's a concern for urethral strictures, fistulas, and granulation tissue. So it's always important to ask about any sort of genital urinary symptoms. And it's always important to be aware of changes in libido and orgasm following surgery. This goes back to one of our P's from the Fenway Clinic. For the chest and pelvic exam, always remember, think about what's necessary for the patient. Discuss your plan for the exam beforehand and use terms the patient is comfortable with. If a patient is binding their chest, also check for skin breakdown. Another important part of every clinical exam is a mental health intake. So it's important to think about what mental health issues a patient might have or social stressors. As we talked about in section one, transgender people might face additional stressors in terms of socioeconomic status and poverty that a lot of our other patients don't experience. Don't assume mental health issues are related to gender identity. And finally, if you feel that your patient is in need of additional resources, check out the SF LGBT Center, Our Family Coalition, and Lesbian, Gay, and Bisexual, Queer and Questioning, Intersex, and Two-Spirit programs, which are great in the Bay Area. Another important aspect of clinical care for our transgender patients is to talk about fertility preservation or family building. According to the World Professional Association for Transgender Health, the Endocrine Society, and the American Society for Reproductive Medicine, it's critical to have discussions about fertility preservation prior to the commencement of gender-affirming medication. Why is that? Well, there is an impact of gender-affirming hormones and treatments on the gonads and gametes. Estrogens may decrease sperm concentration and motility. However, despite having abnormal semen parameters, some transgender women have enough sperm to use for assisted reproduction. Thinking about transgender men, in other words, people with ovaries who are using androgens, in the long term, they may have accelerated loss of ovarian reserve, in other words, less eggs than might be expected for their age. Taking testosterone may be associated with the appearance of polycystic appearing ovaries. And on the other hand, even if you take testosterone, if ovulation is not suppressed, for people having penile vaginal intercourse, they may still conceive spontaneously. So, what are the options that you can advise your patients on for fertility and family building? For one, adoption is always an option. But I'd caution to be careful with this one because you don't want to imply to your transgender patients that they can't have genetically related offspring of their own. It's just important to be broad when you're talking about this. For your patients that are interested in having genetically related offspring, it's important to let them know there are many ways that they can build their family. And finally, if they're not sure, there's always the option to cryopreserve their gametes, either sperm or egg, for the future. Ultimately, it's not who you are, it's what you do. And so I always like to think, you just need sperm, an egg, and a uterus in order to conceive. So for transgender female patients, if they're single, in other words, they do not have a partner, their best option for having genetically related children would be to use IVF with a gestational carrier and donor egg. If they're partnered with a cisgender female, they have plenty of options, including spontaneous conception, intrauterine insemination, IVF, and possibly IVF with a gestational carrier if medically necessary. And of course, this will depend on the patient's clinical scenario, their partner, and their preferences. They have very similar options if partnered with a transgender male. If a transgender woman is partnered with a cisgender male or transgender female, their main option is to use IVF with donor egg and a gestational carrier. Thinking about our transgender men, if they are unpartnered, their options include intrauterine insemination, IVF if medically necessary, or IVF with a gestational carrier. If they're partnered with a cisgender female or transgender male, their options include using intrauterine insemination with donor sperm, using IVF with donor sperm if medically necessary, or using IVF with donor sperm and a gestational carrier if medically necessary. If a transgender man is partnered with a cisgender man or transgender female, they have plenty of options, from spontaneous conception all the way to IVF with a gestational carrier and with their partner's sperm. But again, all of this depends on the patient's preference. To summarize parts 1 and 2, always determine the correct pronouns and names that your patient prefers. Do not assume your patient is transitioning. Know that there are several non-medical ways that a patient may affirm their gender. And also, when people do seek gender-affirming medical interventions, it requires a multidisciplinary team and following specific eligibility criteria. Summarizing parts 3 and 4, know that gender-affirming interventions may include gender-affirming hormones or surgery. Transgender people using gender-affirming hormones or after surgery should be followed on a regular basis by a multidisciplinary team. I hope that this four-part lecture has been helpful for you and that you'll feel more prepared as you see your transgender, gender-expansive, non-binary, and non-conforming patients on the floor. They'll really appreciate it.